Hello and welcome to episode 4 of the Fearless Hour and a Half. I'm D. Patrick Miller, the producer of this Time for Saving Graces, and here with me is co-host Dr. Tameer Siddiqui.
Wow.
This episode is devoted to the saving grace of self-knowledge, and we're featuring two talented guests who know a thing or two about knowing themselves. San Francisco indie musician Megan Slankard provides us with three videos in three different styles. And the interview for this show features the Reverend Nhien Vuong. She's a licensed Unity minister and founder of Evolving Enneagram. That's an educational organization teaching the principles of the map of consciousness known as the Enneagram. After Megan's first song, we'll also hear what Dr. Tameer has to say on the subject of self-knowledge. Now, this is always a pleasant surprise for me because I don't direct or script her, and she always brings something unexpected into the mix. Plus, she has an education. This is our fourth full-length episode. After this, we're going to take a break to review what we've done so far and where we might go with this video experiment. Although I managed to edit the first episode neatly into 1 hour, the others have run a little long, including this one. But I've eased back on my perfectionist clock-watching tendencies to let each episode fill itself out to a natural shape. The show's not really meant to be watched once and forgotten. In fact, I've designed it as a resource that you can return to. That's why there's a schedule of segments for each show on its YouTube page, so that you can pinpoint a piece of music or presentation to review or catch up to for the first time. As Tameer and I review what we've been up to, we'd love to hear your opinions and suggestions. Just write to us at info@fearlessbooks.com. And you can catch up on all the episodes, including the pilot with Tameer's magic trick, at www.fearlessbooks.com. And although we are taking a breather on full-length episodes, there is a shorter Fearless Extra coming up later this month, which features Tameer in an exclusive interview with authors Gary Renard and Cindy Laura Renard. So tell us a little bit about that.
Absolutely. I am so excited. This is going to be a wonderful opportunity to just meet with Gary and Cindy, see how they're doing, and talk about current events, talk about this pandemic, talk about forgiveness, and see if they have any updates for us.
Great. Thanks. So let's keep moving. It's time to meet an indie rocker whom I first interviewed way back in the mists of time, Megan Slankard. Hi, I'm here with Megan Slankard, singer-songwriter from San Francisco, who used to be a kid. and the way I know that is the first time I interviewed you, you were 20, maybe 22?
Probably.
We were introduced by David Knopfler, who was on a previous show. And right at that time, I happened to know an editor at Acoustic Guitar. Told him about you, he checked into you, and so I did a feature story. That was the first time I had ever talked to you. And I want you to know, Megan, that was the beginning and the end of my career in rock music journalism.
And what a way to go out.
even at that age, it was a little late to get my foot in the door at Rolling Stone. You know, the whole Cameron Crowe thing was a little bit beyond
another era. It was another time.
So for people who don't know anything about you, probably one of the first things they know is that you should know is that your rise to fame really began when your family nominated you, or more technically turned you in to a show called What Not to Wear.
Indeed it did.
And I hate to be cruel, but I still have a fond memory of the part in the show where you're stumbling in high heels because you'd never worn them before.
Honestly, I still stumble in high heels. My trademark.
I would too, but I haven't tried. tried it. I've just been wondering, you know, like, how are you getting along with the pandemic and so forth? I mean, it's. I think I have the greatest sympathy for musicians in this whole mess, because it's a little bit harder. I mean, musicians are certainly going online and doing their thing, but it's a little bit harder, I think.
It's been interesting, for sure. As a full-time touring artist, I'm used to being on the road 200 dates a year, so I've never seen the inside of my house for this long. But man, my bathroom tile grout is very clean. It's been a challenge on more than one front. Which is interesting, I am actually a super introverted person. So I thought, oh, this pandemic is gonna be no problem. It's gonna be a snap. But I still rely, while I am introverted and it's not my go-to to go out and do things and, you know, be around crowds. Funny thing to say as a musician, but I still do rely on that energy and connection with other humans. And it's just that I need time to recuperate in between. And so my tendency when I'm just by myself is there's been a lot of talking to my plants and eating food over the sink, but that's okay because I've stepped up the collaboration on many fronts. I've stepped up the creative collaboration, recording and, you know, multi-city recording and writing songs together with other people and getting people to be on my recordings. It's been super fun. So we find ways, we adapt, but financially it's been, it's been a little hard, and emotionally I think has been quite a challenge.
Right. But. Right. So on this show, we're going to do three songs of yours, all pre-recorded videos. The first is Bones Live Forever. We'll talk about that a little bit later. The second one is a Beatles cover, and I would like you to say a little bit about how important the Beatles were to you, and because I know that it was at the very beginning of your musical awareness.
Yes. Well, my parents always played lots of music when we were growing up. Just they, you know, always jamming on CDs everywhere. And I always remember like dancing with my siblings, just being like kids, tiny kids, like dancing up and down while my dad would be jamming tunes, like working late afternoons. The Beatles really spoke to me after my parents introduced me to one of their movies. It's called Help. I don't know if you've ever seen it, but it's,
oh yeah, long time ago.
Ridiculous. But as a 10-year-old, I was like, this is my jam and this is what I want to do. I had wanted to be a veterinarian before then, and all of that just went evaporated immediately. There was something about it that just spoke to me to my very core. And it wasn't necessarily like discovering something new, it was like discovering something about yourself that you already had. And I was like, oh yeah, this is what I can see now. This is what I've been meant to do my entire life. And, you know, my version of success has sort of changed around it, but the Beatles have followed me through every aspect of my career, just always loving. And I'm a Paul McCartney girl all the way. I mean, I'm all the Beatles, but Paul McCartney's my man.
Right. The last piece in the show is going to actually give people a glimpse of how you are performing now. That KC, your manager, has got you not exactly out on the road, but in the driveway.
In the driveway. Yeah, the driveway concert tour is actually an idea. I talked to Casey March or early pandemic, and I was like, I have this great idea. I saw this picture of this guy in Italy standing on his van playing a guitar, and I was like, KC, you need to make a series out of this. And at first KC was like, I don't know if that's gonna work, but after we talked about it for a while and sort of collaborated on this idea, just like, make it a series, KC Turner Presents, bring artists to people in a super safe and socially distanced way, and it gave us all the ability to see real live humans in 3D, and it was really great.
Right. So I want to get to the first song that's going to play right after we talk. And this is the one that really I thought of when I was doing this show theme on self-knowledge, because it's a little video enactment of you battling it out with your shadow. And I won't give it away and tell who wins. but then I read the lyrics. And I suddenly realized, Megan looks like this, like, nice and sweet pop singer, but she's actually a surrealist, at heart.
True.
With a whole different agenda than what we imagine. If you wouldn't mind reading those.
Not at all.
You never hear lyrics in rock songs, and this is a really hard, hard rocking song. So I want people to get a little preview of it.
Yeah.
What you're saying, and also that way they can go back and they want to review the lyrics, because it's just a fascinating piece all the way around.
Well, I'm glad you find it so. yeah, this is called Bones Live Forever. I'm used to singing it, so we'll see how it goes. There were times I was alone, dangerously close to boredom. There were seeds living in my soul, growing weeds in all my questions. Like, do bones live forever? Can you knock out the wind before it goes on and chatters? How long will rope last in a river? Will the fibers get thin when they're soaking in the water? I'm home again. It didn't take a lifetime. I should lose my way much more often. It keeps me always looking forward. Do scars have a sense of humor? Could I find out with a match and some paper? Next time you write a letter, go ahead, seal it, and address it to the water. My wavering concentration can go straight to hell. Not a war would imbalance me. Do nerves sit still when they find what they're after? Can a boat whisper the changes to the rudder? There's a pattern I'd like to alter. I found out you're not drinking enough water. It's not a good sign, not a good sign, not a good sign. That damn tide. Yes, I gotta get this timed. I gotta try to get it on my side. It's a good side, it's a good side, it's a good side. But every time I counted on you, you lost your way. If a knot's too tight, will it tell me with a shudder? If I never came home, when would they discover? How long will a rope last in a river? Will the fibers get thin when they're dead out in the water?
Great. We got a little bit of a water theme going on.
Perhaps.
Going on there. Thanks very much. People can study that for a while.
And that's especially, just one of the songs on that album.
Especially after they've seen the video. After your Beatles cover, that has your Patreon com address, so that will show. So is that really the best place for people to connect with you? Should they go to your website? Should they?
Well, if people like the music and want to find more and be part of the creative process, Patreon is the best way to both be a part of, I call it living art, because you get brand new art from me every month, but it's also the best way to support me as an artist, because for somebody to donate, you know, $2 or $5 a month, whatever they can afford, really goes a really long way to help me stay sustainable and keep the bills paid and keep art being created.
Right. $5 is at least one meal over the sink. I mean,
yeah, one sink meal. That's one burrito or bowl of oatmeal over the sink that I can eat while talking to my plants. Yeah, absolutely. Or they can just visit me on, follow me on Spotify, visit me at my website, meganslankard.com. But Patreon is definitely more of an interactive, fun.
Okay, great. Well, I'm used to seeing you perform once or twice a year. That's been over a year.
Yeah.
And this is a weird way to do it, but great to see you.
It's so good to see you. Thanks for having me.
And thanks for playing along.
Absolutely. It's been a pleasure.
Okay. Bye-bye.
Bye. Thanks, Patrick.
There were times I was alone, dangerously close to boredom, seeds living in my soul, growing weeds and all my questions, like the bones live forever. Can you knock out the wind before it goes on and shatter? The lone road blasting in the river, where the thighs get thin and the soul get in the water. I am home again. Didn't take a lifetime. I should lose my way much more often. It keeps me always looking forward. The scars of a sense of humor. Could I find out where the matches and burger? Next time you write a letter, or oh, I can't see it and I'm driven to the water. Oh, 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 oh.
How do you feel about your parents and childhood? How do you respond to stress? How do you handle criticism? What do you live for? What would you die for? How do you make every day meaningful to you? We spend much of our life exploring other people's backgrounds, interests, fears, goals, sometimes at the expense of getting to know our own. Psychologists, particularly followers of Freud, would say that much of our self is an iceberg, and that the 10% of the iceberg that is out of the water commonly referred to as our conscious state, is who people think they are most of the time. This is the perspective humans generally take to understand their own humanity. This fundamental lack of awareness people have of themselves can make them miserable. The journey to know yourself frees you from being a slave to the other 90% of the iceberg referred to as the unconscious. Only when we know our patterns and where they came from can we manage them effectively. Understanding our histories keeps us from blindly repeating unproductive past patterns. It can also result in a kinder and more compassionate view of who we really are. When Socrates said, "Know thyself," I believe he was referring to the self-knowledge that enables us to be more proactive in response to both internal and external events. If we truly know our patterns, our triggers, and our pleasures, and if we have the emotional intelligence to recognize our feelings as they happen, we are much less likely to be dominated by them. When my clients come to therapy, they recognize the need to learn more about themselves because that is a necessary first step for initiating the kind of positive change that they want to make in their lives. So how do we develop self-knowledge in real time? We practice mindfulness, and in doing so, we make more of the unconscious conscious by becoming attuned to ourselves in the present moment without judgment. We take responsibility for our upsets and own our power to choose how to see things and make changes if we are dissatisfied. And finally, we practice acceptance. We work to notice and accept whatever arises instead of succumbing to distraction and procrastination. By practicing mindfulness, taking responsibility, and cultivating acceptance of ourselves, we are better able to take a step back, learn more about ourselves, and become the change that we seek.
Wednesday morning at 5 o'clock as the day begins. Silently closing her bedroom door, leaving a note that she hoped would say more. She goes downstairs to the kitchen, clutching her handkerchief. Quietly turning the back door key, stepping outside, she is free. We gave her most of our life.
Is leaving.
Sacrificed most of our life.
Oh. Thank you.
meeting a man from the motor train. She
When I was thinking of a theme for this show on self-knowledge, I actually scribbled down the words higher self, but something bothered me about that. And I realized that it's an idea I don't actually believe in. Along any spiritual path, I don't think we become higher or more pure or perfected. I think we evolve to become more capable, more diversely skilled, more self-aware, and more conscientious of others' needs and struggles. It's not like we clear out all our flaws or weaknesses and become higher or better than anyone else. But we do learn to make the most of what we have and gain more dimensions to our self rather than just rising up to some higher state. To the degree that we are conscious and involved with our own evolution, we can say that we're living spiritually rather than just dealing with whatever life throws at us. Our featured guests for this show, the Reverend Nhien Vuong, hi, has probably evolved more than anyone I know. First, she was born in Vietnam and rapidly evacuated during the fall of Saigon in 1975 with her family, thus initiating her first profound evolution into becoming an Asian American. But that was beyond her control, something that life just threw at her. Much later, Nhien earned a law degree at Stanford where, as she once told me, she was kind of bored due to the lack of challenge, which remains a little scary.
I don't remember saying that. That might be, God, does that sound like me? Man.
I just remember.
Maybe spiritual challenge, the lack of.
Yeah, maybe that was it. Despite rapidly achieving the comfortable lifestyle of a San Francisco attorney, she initiated her spiritual evolution to become a student of A Course in Miracles, prayer chaplain at Unity Church, and eventually a licensed Unity minister. More recently, she founded Evolving Enneagram, an educational organization which, in her words, takes an inter-spiritual approach to global transformation. Now, the Enneagram has long been known as a personality typing system, but Nhien calls it a map of consciousness, and I'll have her explain that. Whatever you call it, the Enneagram has exploded in popularity in recent years after its initial introduction to the US in the 70s. Now, Nhien's latest achievement or evolution is surviving COVID-19. So saying that I'm glad to welcome you here goes double. Maybe you can tell us just a few words about how that went for you and how you see your own evolution up to this point.
Yes. Wow. Okay. Just a few little topics. First, COVID. I have to tell you, I had definitely, despite all my work in terms of spiritual surrender, my first reaction to COVID was, I've been so good. I've been home all year. Like, why me? I actually didn't even believe it. When I started getting sick, I was like, no. And then when I lost my sense of smell, like I have all these little oils next to the bed, peppermint to help me breathe. And I was using them every night. One night I turned to them. I couldn't tell in the dark which oil was which. And wow. I'm like, oh, and it was just this really, this it was scary moment, really. I'm not someone who's normally very cognizant, you know, you've known me in the past, like, have I remembered to eat? I'm not sure. You know, I'm not that cognizant of like my bodily needs, but in that moment, sort of the fragility of my physical being was really alive for me. And I, if anything, I think what it did for me is I tend to be a person of great passion. And in a way, sometimes, even though I'm better now, like neglecting my body, like if it's tired, I still move. It's that kind of thing. Mm-hmm. And I feel like what that time did for me about 2 weeks, like it was bad. Like it hurt. Like, and I had this moment of like compassion. It built compassion for people who suffer from physical ailments, like chronic physical pain, like in a new way. Like I had a new sort of appreciation for what it takes to even just want to get up out of bed in the morning. So fortunately, I don't feel any side effects now. That was just less than a month ago, really. But for me, if anything, it really, like it was sobering, first around my mortality. And not that, I mean, I'm not in a high risk category, but it really knocked me out, like more than I think people would have expected. Someone who generally is physically fit and exercises a lot, et cetera, and doesn't have any, you know, chronic ailments that made me higher risk, right? So yes, it was just a weird fluke. It happened the same week that my grandmother passed away. I suspect, you know, my immune system was compromised that week as it was. So it was a lot at once, you know. But I feel like, again, I think I've learned that the things that we struggle with, like pain, if we don't let it harden us, if we don't say, oh, pain, this is why I have to be more callous toward the world, but instead sort of submit to it in a way and really feel like everything. When you talk about the descent, path of descent is what I heard you describing, which is the path of going downward, not just the higher self, but like down into my earthy self. And like, I think there's something about recognizing that and being with that, that in some ways brings forth that higher level of universal love and goodness, you know, because we're so in touch with it, with our vulnerability, if you will. And so there's a tenderness, I feel, that naturally arises when we're willing to kind of be with our own pain, physical or emotional, you know. And it was emotional too, because, and you know me, Patrick, that like I love my work and I usually work a lot, right? I couldn't do a thing. I was canceling all these sessions and everything. And so I think it wasn't just the physical being debilitated that way, but sort of like having nothing in me. And here in Kansas City, it was 0 degrees outside. Like I didn't step outside for fresh air for a week, like a good week. That's strange. So everything at once, you know, again, I'm feeling vibrant and great, you know, right now, but yeah, so this is a piece of, you know, the path that you're talking about, which to me is like this path of being with our humanity, I think, in a way that something about spirituality is involved in that, you know, not, it doesn't bypass it, right? Yeah. So,
you know, when I went through chronic fatigue for so many years, the first task I had to learn, the first like shift of perception was to go from fighting the illness to taking care of myself. And that territory of taking care of myself was foreign to me. Mm-hmm. I thought if you got sick, you fought it. And and part of taking care of myself was learning kindness. Now, it sounded like COVID hit you so hard and fast, you didn't have time to fight it.
So I really like I was almost in denial, honestly. Like I didn't really, like, I can't be sick. Am I sick? Like, but I mean, I was just knocked out for a day too. But I was convincing myself it was like, oh, the weather's bad. And maybe I just got sick because my grandmother, and I didn't have all the typical symptoms, you know. Right. And so, yeah, but after losing my sense of smell, I went and got tested, and la la la. Yeah. So I don't know, maybe too many Amazon returns. I mean, like if I went anywhere, it was like to return my Amazon deliveries, you know, basically at UPS. So I mean, I'm able to laugh now, you know, perspective, right. But yeah, it was kind of dreadful, frankly.
I can well imagine. I can say I've been there. Something you said about work, I want to follow up on. For those who know the Enneagram, both Nhien and I are ones for whom work is life. And I have to admit that
historically,
this whole show came up at the beginning of the pandemic. I would never have imagined that I would do a video show. And I kept questioning my own motives. And now that you say that, it's a little embarrassing to realize, I had so much time in my hands with sitting around, I was inventing some more work.
That is
and so since you've always been a hard worker, how do you look at your evolution that I described as a change in the kind of work that you choose to do?
Yes. Well, I'll answer that question as well as something related to my relationship to work. So yes. So in my very classically Asian family, immigrant Vietnamese family, you know, you become a doctor or a lawyer, you know, and so since I sucked in science and math and became a lawyer, you know, it really was that conscious. And so in terms of the evolution of my work, I was actually not even like, I was never religious growing up. I inquired myself, I would read books. I read the Bible. I read Taoism. I read like about every religion, but my family wasn't religious. And my dad at most was philosophically Buddhist. And so we sort of plodded through life, but I always had a penchant for, I mean, I was a philosophy major, this orientation and this bent. And then I found myself, you know, as an attorney in San Francisco, living the good life and completely miserable. And at that point, like after just a few years, like I kept trying to change jobs, thinking, if I change the outer, if I just change to another, it must be this workplace. I kept trying to change the outer situation and it wasn't working, you know, to bring happiness and fulfillment. And part of that, of course, is yes, it was the outer. It was that I didn't feel like my job, my work was benefiting the world on a deep level. That was significant. But I was also lost. I didn't really know my way. And I don't want to get too much detail, but I was also kind of a miserable child. Like I was unhappy in my family of origin. I didn't feel the love of my family. I do now. But back then I was really kind of lost. And it was a day when it was a weekend after I had asked my husband for a divorce and quit my law job that I found the Enneagram. And I
Yes. That was before the course.
That was before. This was before the Course in Miracles.
Oh,
yes.
Oh, okay. I didn't know
but
that.
It was not a spiritual approach at that time. But what it did for me, when I read the description for the one, I cried, and I was like, "This explains what I've been doing my entire life up until now." Up until now, I've been operating on the assumption that there's something fundamentally wrong with me. Like that, and that I had to make up for it by being good, like by being good enough, and that wholeness wasn't intrinsic, you know. And the Enneagram was the first system that suggested otherwise, that suggested that was the fallacy of the type one. And every type, there are 9 numbers around the Enneagram for those who are new, you know, and each type has basically a fundamental false belief. And that belief like governs, you know, a lot of people are reading the Enneagram, as you said, is so popular, right? Well, in its popularity, you're getting all these memes about behaviors, you know, what a type likes to eat for Thanksgiving or, you know, and some of it's funny, but a lot of it can also be misleading because then people start to look at behaviors as evidence of type. Whereas what governs type is motivation. Like in motivation, I would say from this deep belief in something wrong with the universe, like something off, like missing a sense of security, missing a sense of wisdom, missing a sense, in the one's case, that there's fundamental perfection and goodness, like inherent in you and in all. And so that, you know, blew my mind, this notion. And that was the beginning of starting to at first use the Enneagram psychologically, you know, like understanding, and that was helpful. But it wasn't until a few years later that I encountered, well, that I had a spiritual awakening and began that journey. So that was, yes, 2002 was when I first.
And how do you describe that awakening? I mean, what happened exactly?
The awakening was really another kind of bottom, right? It was so that bottom was more of like the, okay, this is not working here. But I hit a point in my life where I'm like, hey, you're smart and you're really trying hard, but you can't seem to be happy. Like life doesn't seem to work or fulfill. And so it was almost like I just collapsed in there. I was in a relationship that was really tumultuous, dramatic. And so that bottom ended me in a 12-step program for relationships and such. And then from that, only a year into that, you know, when someone said, oh, this is a spiritual program, I'm like, huh. Okay, I've been inquiring intellectually, reading books like this, but I didn't have a felt experience of that. And so it took about a year of being in program and working that program. And then I found, guess what? The disappearance of the universe, which happened to be published by D. Patrick Miller, Fearless Books.
Well, you know, it's my goal has been to corrupt minds from the beginning. So.
That was actually kind of the beginning. I found A Course in Miracles through that book. Like, and so then I found a local Unity church that was teaching the book. They had a book study. And oh, that was the beginning of the end of life as I knew it. You know, I mean, I took to it like I knew it already. And that's what it felt like. Well, when I studied A Course in Miracles, I remember people floundering a bit in class and trying to understand. I was like thinking, I know this, like I recognize this. That's how it felt. It felt like I already knew it. And of course, that's a very cocky, you know, sort of
perception. Well, I remember I had the feeling with the course, I recognize this and I wish I did not.
That's hilarious. Yes. Yes. It's, you know, how many people have stories of throwing it over the Golden Gate Bridge, right? Or like my teacher Sharon had these stories of like, oh my God, you know, but you know, for me, it was a relief, you know, that there was some system out there that explained something true within me, you know? And so A Course in Miracles is how I found Unity, which is how, like, so I started going to, what is this church here? You know, I've never gone to a church in my life. And so this was my early 30s. I started attending. Their first lesson was let go and let God. I'm like, huh, that was, you know, very aligned with the 12-step model. And within a year, I was invited to be on the board of directors and I served as a prayer chaplain. I mean, the journey just sped up at that point in terms of like life was sending me somewhere. And I had realized, oh, at the point of my surrender, when I, like for me, when you think you can figure out your life, there's no room for grace and no room for spirit. But I was so down and broken in that moment. I was humble enough that I'm like, clearly, I of my own volition and intelligence cannot figure this out. Can't seem to find fulfillment or like make my life work in any way. And so that was the beginning of a sort of concurrent overriding path of surrendering to a power greater than myself. And I appreciate what you said about higher self, but I also say that it's helpful to some people and helpful at different stages to think of it as, oh, well, it's not the self that I'm ordinarily identified with, but something that lifts me sort of to a higher awareness, if you will, you know, which is not to, you know, do a spiritual bypassing, but there is something about, oh, like somehow by surrendering to something bigger than myself, I started to feel wholeness for the first time in my life. And then through wholeness, which is really just about me, it just was natural that I started to feel more oneness, more belonging, more connection to all of life. And what I experienced was so profound that one day after praying at church, I'm like, I want to do this for the rest of my life. Like, this is like, it was a very clear, I mean, maybe want is too strong of a word. It was like, I'm going to do this for the rest of my life is how it felt, but it felt positive, you know? And so that was the beginning of me transitioning out of law and moving toward ministry. And I'm in Kansas City now because Unity Seminary is here in Kansas City. And so basically after seminary, I stayed here. Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
But now you are focusing your work on the Enneagram. And what I'm interested in, this gets back to this question of yes. map of consciousness. Yes. How has your view of what the Enneagram is and what it's for changed?
Yes. Well, I think that many people were teaching it as a personality typology for years. And some of the mass market right now, it's popularized as such. But the Enneagram is an ancient symbol and system that represents like dynamic transformational processes, right? So right. in a way, it's a map of everything. It's a map of life. In unity, we believe that life is consciousness. So I would say it's a map of consciousness. And that the Enneagram of personality is just one overlay on this map. Like, you know, if you have a map with different levels of terrain that, you know, it shows, and we're saying the personality is the top layer that faces the world. And when you become over-identified with the personality, you forget your wholeness and you're connected to the strategy of that. I often teach when I share the Enneagram, it's like every one of the 9 Enneagram types follows this line in A Course in Miracles, seek but do not find. So it invites you to keep seeking. Like the 6 wants security out in the world. It's trying to build certainty and security, but it can never find it in the world. And so for me, the Enneagram isn't like, oh, hey, this is what you are. It's like the trailhead to the wilderness of your authentic self, the unknown and the mystery of that. Yeah.
Yeah. One thing I've always liked about the Enneagram as opposed to say astrology or even Myers-Briggs, is that it's not just giving you a static identity. Well, here's what you are, and here's what you'll deal with all its complexities of subtypes and wings and directions of growth. The Enneagram does identify what you are in a very compelling way. Right. Most people I know who weep when they really right. recognize their type, but it also shows you. As you say, it's a dynamic
yes.
system of evolution. Right. It's full of energy and movement. It's not just a static label of what you are.
Absolutely. In fact, again, no metaphor is ever fully accurate, but some are more helpful than others. And sometimes I will describe type as a little prison. So when you look at the little dot around the circle, you're like, oh, this is not what you are. This is the prison in which you live, whereas the whole circle represents your wholeness. And so it's almost like there's a gravitational pull to the habits, emotional and mental, of your number. And spiritual freedom and wholeness lies in breaking free of the compulsions of that number so that you can, from the Buddhist term, live more skillfully. Like, what's the most skillful expression in this moment? You're free to choose that, and you're not hampered by, like, say, the one. Well, I'm too worried about being right or wrong, right? And so if I'm hampered by that, there could be a powerful and empowered decision that you could be making right now that is limited because the type's like, but don't be wrong. And so giving yourself permission to do that, and every type has a version of that. And so for me, it's not making the ego wrong at all. It's not making the identification with the personality wrong. It's seeing it as merely limited, you know? And in fact, I would even go further to say it's limited, but ultimately that there's some beauty in the fact that you're uniquely designed to serve a purpose in the world through your type structure, that your type has gifts, but it's just as long as you're fixated, then you're not free to live your full self, if you will. But there's something to that type, yeah.
So what does evolving Enneagram do? What do you do with people? What do you
offer? Oh, and I realized, you know, I didn't really explain like what happened to, between becoming a minister and then evolving Enneagram. And this is part of that story. So I ended up at Unity Temple on the Plaza, which is one of the founders' churches in the Unity movement. I have no idea, really. I did an internship there during school, and I didn't think I was going to be a church minister. I did an internship. They gave me an offer, and suddenly I was accepting. Through prayer, I was like, okay, this is mine to do. So, but I never felt quite like I fit in. You know, I was not excited about Sunday service. I wanted to focus more on transformation. And it felt like, you know, there's a structure to church that can be inhibiting. So I found my way by teaching. And I'm like, this I love. And I started teaching Enneagram classes. And they just kept growing. And the community kept evolving, you know, expanding, but mostly deepening. And what I found is of all the tools I have as a minister, that this was helping people to transform their consciousness at rates I had never seen before. You know, like, I mean, I have couples in their 80s who, you know, they have a great, generally great marriage, but like both of them, like it's just escalated to another level because of their increased like self-awareness. You talk about self-knowledge. And, but so people from like any age really meeting this. So what happened was, I mean, one's value efficacy, right? And do like, what's going to maximize my do-goodness in the world? And I just felt like everything else was a distraction from that work. And so in September of only 2019, I was selling someone, not that long ago, really, I went off on my own and established Evolving Enneagram. And what we do is I do one-on-ones with folks where I work with you, if you know your type, I look at offsetting. So what we work on is offsetting the compulsion of type. Again, not making it wrong, but recognizing, oh, that looks awfully like your Enneagram pattern. Maybe it's not a free choice you're making there, you know, things like that. So a lot of one-on-one work, I actually work with companies now. But my little requirement on that is they actually know I'm a minister. I mean, like, I don't fake like I don't fake secular talk. And it's amazing to be able to do that and feel authentic. But the primary thing that Evolving Enneagram is known for, in fact, the IEA in Denmark, we just had a Zoom meeting yesterday because they had heard about my work building community, building Enneagram literate conscious community that's transformational. And so we had like a Q&A for an hour and 15 minutes to explore how they could do that in Denmark. And that's so exciting, right? So these are members of the board of the International Enneagram Association there and some of the volunteers. But so the core work that I would say that Evolving Enneagram is starting to be known for is community building. It is Harville Hendricks who said, you know, we are born in relationship, we are wounded in relationship, and we can be healed in relationship. And so the groups, in a way, provide a mini world, a world where, oh, lo and behold, someone who's a 9 who's married to an 8 ends up in a group with 3/8 of it, right? You know, like it's that sort of karma, you know, where the grace of healing through these dynamics that happen. So I lead these contemplative Enneagram groups 2 hours weekly, started with one. I started with one for 10 weeks and they didn't want to stop. And that one has been going for 3.5 years. Wow. So yeah. And so it's really like, when people start to see, people will always see like the other person growing first. They're like, oh my God, so-and-so is not even the same man I saw a year ago. And I'm like, that's what they're saying about you. So, you know, don't dismiss your own like growth. But so in these groups, we do 20 minutes of silence, which is so unusual these days, right? You know, people talk about meditating, but church services have maybe 5 minutes or 10 minutes. So that's only one of the things. So one-on-ones, the ideal person, you know, the ideal participant, they grow the fastest when they do one-on-one so that we can work on what's showing up in these groups. Then they do these weekly groups and it becomes their spiritual community. You know, there are folks who don't like church or who aren't comfortable in church. But for many, they really see it as their spiritual home now. So that's pretty profound. The other thing I do that's evolved, there's something organic that happens where those are the two main things. I teach the Enneagram separately. The groups barely have any teaching because we're too much in our head if we overteach. You might've been in some A Course in Miracles classes where it feels like it's all like head stuff and figuring out stuff as opposed to sort of entering into the essence. And so I deal with that by primarily teaching in a very separate forum. And then we bring our Enneagram informed learning into our presence together. But the group itself has no crosstalk rules, no interruptions, no advice giving. And so what happens is you have to sit in your own stuff. And I have a joke that, you know, if you let someone talk, if you don't interrupt them with what you think you know, how you can help them or rush them, they will ramble their way into wisdom, you know?
Yeah, if there's a no advice rules, I don't see how you let ones into the group at all.
Well, that's where I want to speak. Oh, you reminded me. I wanted to speak to the evolution of that, you know, because I mean, it is funny to be like, oh yeah, there's, I think the reason like we want to laugh about it is it's like, there are things we do that hurt ourselves, right? Like that overwork and to like, oh yeah, you do that too. It's like, oh, you know, there's an ease in that. But I think ultimately it's like now it's a weird thing, but as a general matter, I wouldn't even say that I work hard. Like, I don't feel like I do. It's something has shifted in sort of a connection to like an ease and a flow and a permission to let go of like this. It's like, why do I have to work so hard all the time? Oh, my ego pats itself on the back for how much I sacrifice. And it's like, that's an attachment to an identity that the more I let go, go figure, life is so much easier, more in flow. And I play more, you know, in fact, right before here, it's a Friday. Imagine, I was just out with friends for 2 hours in the park. We were just visiting.
Oh my God, you're losing control completely.
I'm losing it. And I was like, yeah, like it's a, like, because it's my life. You know, that's not something that was unfathomable. I mean, I remember at my law firm when I spent an all-nighter and you could just feel in the air how proud everyone was and how good of a thing that was. And like, I hadn't slept and changed clothes, you know, like, I'm like, that's a different world. I'd live in a different world. And not to say I work a lot, but there's something different about my mentality. And in fact, if I find myself like, the other day, I was like, oh my gosh, this is a busier schedule today. It was like a 14-hour day or something that I have had in a while. I found myself rushing to the kitchen and I slowed and I just went, because in a beneficent universe, you are not asked to sacrifice your well-being in order to have good. So I'm going to trust my good comes without having to rush an effort for it. Right. Like that's like a profound shift in how I, if you've known me for the past, a profound shift.
Yeah.
Right. Before you could probably like take the work stuff away from my hands and I'd be like grabbing it back, you know? So, right.
Well, yeah. Just to make sure that you work hard here. The last thing I wanted to ask you about is, you talked about community building with the Enneagram, and I wanted to know what do you think is the potential of the awareness spawned by the Enneagram for really tough social problems? For instance, as an Asian American, yes. I'm sure you're acutely aware of the craziness that's going on now. How do you see what you do as helping to heal those kind of problems?
Yes, well, I can tell you that in my groups, we recently said this. I was like, you know, the way these groups are set up to connect more like essence to essence, you now love people whom you would have never been friends with had you met them in a regular way. Like, and then, but so it really cuts beneath, like there's something essential that happens. And I won't say it's just the Enneagram. It's this contemplative but interspiritual approach where all people of all faiths or all questioning are welcome. right? So there's a space in which, oh, we're not here to debate. People can share their own with I statements. So people can hear perspectives probably that they've never heard outside. I mean, I heard one woman one time share that, like, I mean, something a little bit smaller, but environmental issues. One woman was about to have a birthday party. It was like more on the conservative side of things. Someone else in the group was sharing, someone else she respected happened to be sharing about, you know, preserving the environment, this and that. And so this woman decided for her birthday party, she was going to get the, you know, not the plastic plates and such, that like something happened that no one tried to make happen in a shift right. around that. And I see that kind of thing happening a lot. But I want to say, I also have explicitly taught the Enneagram and how it factors in, how your personality construct factors into your anti-racism work, actually. And so you can look at like, where does this personality structure, where does it default in a way that can sabotage that journey? You know, whether it's the one's judgment, you know, or the black and white thinking and things like that, that don't build the bridges, that don't look beneath into essence, right? Or so where someone's threatened, you know, we have twos where it's hard for a two to acknowledge and think that they're not a good person. So imagine if you have a two who's always been very generous and kind to people of all races, like to admit I'm a racist is a big deal. So understanding that the personality construct really struggles to think of yourself as anything other than a generous and beneficent person, right? That you have to overcome that and recognize that both can be true, that you can have effected harm, you know, but by knowing type, I can be more sensitive to the ways that a type might be stuck in opening to a new idea. So that's how it can be done personally as well as structurally. So I guess one answer is participation in groups like these help people be exposed to, in a safe way, new ideas in a way where they're like, oh, someone, I mean, people have said, oh, well, oh my God, I can't believe this person voted for Trump. Like, this is a loving person. And before, I just thought everyone who voted for Trump was a horrible person. Like, there's something that opens there in that space. That's one. The other thing is, if you're working one-on-one with the Enneagram, then you can look at these barriers to opening to a new idea, opening to a new idea of yourself, really, right? Because there's an admission here of like, what's going on. Then you can even look at the instinctual stackings on the Enneagram, which is another complex area, and go, oh, certain stackings like yours, self-pres, tend to be more conserving of what is. There's a like not wanting things. Mine, sexual, is like explode it all, dynamite, and let's figure it out, you know? Like, and so recognizing, and then the social is more about like sort of navigating sort of the social realm of like group identity, et cetera. And so looking at how each category can get like more triggered and how each can get met. Like I can imagine that some of the more conservative types are like, we like how things have been. We don't trust what could happen if there's a new. Maybe I fear I won't be included in the new. And so how do we have a conversation around that? Nine energy tends to fear that they don't matter, that they're not included as it is. So I can imagine bringing a male, white, self-preservation nine into a journey about maybe women's empowerment, which I've actually done before, involves recognizing that he needs to feel like he's not going to be left out of that new paradigm. But he actually has a very good intention to want to join. It's that kind of thing.
Well, I just hope that if Trump has enough time left in his lifespan to bottom out, I hope you're there. I'd love to see you take this totally out of control, unreflective eight. And
well, if you believe what I believe, which is, I mean, maybe you do with the Course of Miracles, that consciousness really is linked, right? Like there is something to be said about the higher we hold him, like the more of that intrinsic love will express. And that's hard when the outer actions seem to be very worthy of the opposite, right? And that's, I think, our work. In some ways, there are people on the other side who feel that way about the liberal side. And so that's where there's an impasse, right? I mean, we joke about it, like, you know, but really, like, nothing will happen. This reconciliation can't happen when people are still like demonizing the other side, and that understanding that there is no other, you know, that like that there really is no other, but without bypassing it, without just saying that, but actually dealing with your own perception and your feelings and your frustration and your fear that this otherness will harm us unless we punish it, unless we damn it and condemn it, you know? And so in that, I feel like our work, like the more that we sort of awaken to love, I would say, that the more that this, that we can trust that this impacts the whole, as long as it, and love isn't divisive. Oh, on a final note about community. Recently, a local nonprofit asked me to donate services, and this is a nonprofit that helps women in recovery, fresh out of prison, to have jobs, skills sewing. And what I knew immediately that this community, there are some communities like that are like, ooh, we're better, we're great. It's about us and it's about how we treat ourselves. And for me, true conscious community is about how we are in the world too. It's how we treat each other, yes. But like, I already knew that everyone would be eager to jump in and help expand into the local community and support, you know, these people who to be more empowered in their lives. And that's a tangible thing. That's not just prayer. That's like hands-on coming in, volunteering, et cetera. So that's one thing that is vital. This notion that true community, I believe, doesn't reinforce this, we're better than them. But we may see more. I may see that I'm one with someone, even if they don't see that they're one with me, you know, that kind of thing. And, you know, and not to say, I mean, I do that very imperfectly, but it's my aspiration. And it seems right. The more that I open, the more that we open, the easier it is, right. You know? Yeah. Yeah. So I hope that answers.
Yes. Yes. And, I'm going to have to close us down here, but one thing I want to do is, the show usually ends with a meditation, kind of a set piece that's music or so forth. I've never had an honest to God minister on the show before. So following the themes of what we've talked about, if you could do, you know, I know you can do this off the cuff, a short prayer just to take us out and then the show will end with a piece of music.
Sure. Do you want a prayer or meditation?
Like up to you.
Okay. I'll do a kind of just a brief meditation, okay. Like a guided meditation. So Patrick and everyone, I invite you to join me in closing your eyes in this moment, if it's safe to do so from wherever you're listening. And I invite you to drop into your physical body and bring awareness to the fullness of your body right here and right now. Seeing if you can notice and observe the sensations in your body. Maybe there's anxiety in the tummy or a fluttering. Simply notice if you can without judgment. Paying attention, compassionate attention as an act of love. And then I invite you to gently let your attention rise into your heart space. And notice without judgment what you're feeling. Or what feeling is wanting to emerge. Maybe hopefulness, or maybe there's some sadness there that you didn't realize. Simply notice if you can without judgment. And then bring awareness up into your mental space. And don't follow the thoughts, but simply be aware of your thinking. Maybe your thoughts are speeding along or diffuse and scattered. Simply notice the quality of your thinking. Best you can without judgment. Bringing loving attention. That mind can work so hard for you. And now I invite you to intentionally open your mind to the fullness of the infinite wisdom and intelligence that is available to you from all around you and from within you. Open mind. And then I invite you to drop your attention down into your heart space and noticing where you might feel blocked at all. Opening your heart only as much as you're willing. Opening perhaps to a love that is unconditional, everywhere present, being available to that love from you and all around you. And then dropping your attention back into your whole body. Noticing where it might be held or tense and consciously relaxing it, bringing a suppleness and receptivity to your bearing. A suppleness to meet the world, to engage it fully, embodied. Relaxed body, open heart, and open mind. We give thanks for you and the unique expression of the one power, one love, and one light that we are together and also as an individuated expression of that whole, both. And so we give thanks and say amen.
Thank you, Reverend. I'm so glad to have caught you on an upswing. just thanks for being here. It was wonderful.
Yeah, absolutely. Thanks so much.
All righty. Bye.
Bye.
All the demons in your head, trying to get you to go back to bed. Watch you chasing dreams they say you'll never catch. Sometimes it feels like they're gonna get away. A break. Floor is creaking, groaning under all the weight. Sometimes it feels like it's going to give away. It's just what you need to lean into a leap of faith. Come on, let's go. Turn on the news, you feel the cinching of a noose. It's like we're shaking, losing all our bolts and screws. Sometimes it feels like it's all gonna break. Baby, won't you let it ring? You don't owe nobody anything. No, that's it, somewhere inside our sins. Sometimes it feels like it's gonna lose away. Maybe it is. what you need to lean into a leap of faith. Come on, let's go. Come on, let's go. Come on, let's go. You got this. Come on, let's go. Let's go.